I'm excited. I think God's got an incredible word for you and for everybody who's here with us today. You might be wondering about the door behind me. We've been in a series called Doors. If you've been with us, we've been doing a lot of different doors that affect your life, right? So we did the door to your prayer closet, about the importance of prayer and having that set apart time. We did a door to the church, talking about the importance of community. We did a door to the blessings of God on your life. Pastor Jerry talked last week. Next week, you're gonna hear about the door to the bedroom. So don't miss out on that. That's a great week to check your kids into childcare. I mean, into Daystar Kids, and let them enjoy that time. And come next week, don't miss out on that series, on that day. But today, I wanna talk about the door to your home. The door to your home. And you might be looking at this door being like, that does not look like my door to my home. Unless I was trying paint colors, you know, and doing swatches. But I want to talk about this, how the door to our home is to be marked by Jesus. And if you remember, in the Old Testament, 3,300 years ago, 1,300 years before Jesus was born, there was the first Passover. And in the Passover, they marked the top and the sides of the door with the blood of the lamb to set apart that family, to set apart and signify that that family followed the Lord. And today I wanna talk about how that has so much significance, that symbolism, that prophetic foreshadowing, it matters for you today. And I wanna talk about what is a home that's marked by the blood of Jesus supposed to look like? What is it that we are supposed to allow into our home? What is it that we're supposed to remove from our home? How does God want us to live in the culture that we live in? Our culture is not much different than back then. You know, the Israelites were in a culture that was very in conflict with their beliefs, right? And so they had to adjust. They had to see, how do we stand for what we believe in the middle of a culture that doesn't stand for what we believe, that doesn't celebrate the same values? Does that sound familiar? Does that sound like something you might be dealing with in our culture and in our life today, right? The more our culture goes in the way it's going, the greater contrast there is between the people of God and the culture. So today I want to dive into scripture. I want to go a little deep today. Is that okay with you? We've been doing this thing called Jesus 365, and if you don't know what that is, basically it's just a challenge that we've initiated as a church for you to spend time in God's word daily, 365 days a year. And last year, we did the Bible in a year as a whole church. And if you did that with us, that was so incredible. We got to read the entire Bible together in a year and see the breadth of the Bible, the whole scope of everything, right? This year is about going deeper. This year, the challenge for you is to go deeper into the Word of God. You may not read the whole Bible, but you can go into some areas of the Bible and begin to go dig deep. And if you don't know how to do that, you should join a small group. There's Jesus 365 small groups at all the campuses. And you can get in with other people and dive into the Word of God together. But if you're good with me diving into the Word of God today, would somebody say amen? Amen. Awesome. Let's go into Exodus 12. Exodus chapter 12 today. And I wanna go ahead and read this in the good old school hard copy of my Bible. And we're gonna read through a significant portion here of Exodus 12. I'm going to skip a few verses just for time's sake. I want to read the account of this first Passover. Now, to set the stage for this real quick, if you haven't are familiar with this story, the Israelites have been in Egypt for 400 years, and they've grown in numbers over and over again. They've been in slavery for most of that time to the Egyptians, all right? So right before this moment that we're about to read, the Israelites finally cried out to God. They'd had enough. They decided, we're done. God, help us. I don't know why it took them 400 years, but it did. It says that was the time the groans and their cries and their help, finally they reached out to God instead of trying to do it on their own. And then God sends Moses. You probably know the story. Moses goes to the Pharaoh and he says, let my people go. And Pharaoh says, no. First plague comes. Pharaoh says, yes. And then let my people go. Yes, no, yes, no. And now at this moment, 9 of the plagues have happened. Okay, there's one plague left, and it's the most significant and destructive plague that's gonna be against the firstborn of Egypt and against the gods of Egypt. So let's pick it up right there. The Israelites, there's 4 million of them at this point. And they're about to, all 4 million people, they're about to experience the night where God's gonna liberate them. He's gonna break them all free all at once, from the captivity and from the slavery they've been in. So let's go to chapter 12, We'll start in verse 3. So announce to the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each family must choose a lamb or a young goat and sacrifice, for a sacrifice, one animal for each household. If a family is too small to eat a whole animal, let them share with another family in the neighborhood. Divide the animal according to the size of each family and how much they can eat. Skip into verse 6. Take special care of this chosen animal until the evening of the 14th day of the first month. Then the whole assembly of the community of Israel must slaughter their lamb or young goat at twilight. They are to take some of the blood and smear it on the sides and the top of the door frames of the houses where they eat the animal. That same night, they must roast the meat over a fire and eat it along with bitter salad greens and bread made without yeast. Skip down to verse 11. These are the instructions for eating this meal. Be fully dressed, wear your sandals, and carry your walking stick in your hand. Eat the meal with urgency, for this is the Lord's Passover. On that night, I will pass through the land of Egypt and strike down every firstborn son, firstborn male animal in the land of Egypt. I will execute judgment against all the gods of Egypt. For I am the Lord, but the blood on your doorposts will serve as a sign marking the houses where you are staying. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. This plague of death will not touch you, even when I strike the land of Egypt. This is a day to remember each year from generation to generation. You must celebrate this as a special festival to the Lord, for this is a law for all time. For 7 days, the bread you eat must be made without yeast. On the first day of the festival, remove every trace of yeast from your homes. Anyone who eats bread made with yeast during the 7 days of the festival will be cut off from the community of Israel. On the first day of the festival, again, on the seventh day, all the people must observe an official day for holy assembly. No work of any kind is to be done except the preparation of food. Amen. celebrate this festival of unleavened bread, for it will remind you that I brought your forces out of the land of Egypt on this very day. This festival will be a permanent law for you. Celebrate this day from generation to generation. Now, that's a long story, and you might be wondering, how in the world does that story have anything to do with my life? I want to show you today. There are so many prophetic parallels, so many significant things in this story that can connect to how we are called as people of God to live. The first one, and the most important one that I want to point out to you, is that everything in this Passover, in fact, everything in the Old Testament, but everything in this Passover story points to Jesus. The Passover is a prophetic foreshadowing of Jesus and his life. And that's so clear as we dive into this. Listen to this, 1 Corinthians 5, this is the end, second part of verse 7, first part of verse 8. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. So let us celebrate the festival, not with the old bread of wickedness and evil, but with the new bread of sincerity and truth. I didn't even realize this till this morning that we were gonna have communion today. If you guys remember, in that moment, Jesus was having Passover with his disciples, okay? So he took the bread that was made without yeast and he broke it and he said, instead of this bread is no longer signifying the lamb, this bread is gonna signify my body which is given for you. And then the Passover wine had to be red because it signified the blood of the lamb that was slain. And he said, this blood, this wine is symbolic now, no longer of the lamb, but it is symbolic of my blood, which is poured out for you. So today, church, you know how it says in there that this is supposed to be celebrated from generation to generation. And I don't know about you, I don't sacrifice animals anymore. Anybody? Maybe don't raise your hand. When I was in Uganda a couple weeks ago, we were in the middle of a worship service and a goat was brought to the front to the offering at our Daystar Uganda campus, all right? So one of our team members was like, I saw that goat walking up front and I was like, if they kill that thing, I'm out of here. I don't know what's going on, but they did not sacrifice the goat at the altar of the Daystar. Don't worry about that. They were bringing it up because that's what they had to give. And it was a beautiful offering. I saw that goat later on tied out on a little post by the back door and then I didn't see it anymore. So I think that goat maybe came part of lunch, I don't know, but it was an offering to the Lord. Now we don't do that anymore, but today we still celebrate, we still remember, we still mark our lives when we take communion that Jesus Christ is our Passover lamb, that Jesus Christ has paid and his blood has purchased us from generation to generation now and forevermore. Can I get an amen? That's what we're celebrating when we take communion. That Jesus fulfilled it once and for all. Thank you, Jesus, that we don't have to sacrifice lambs and rub them on the top of our door anymore. I mean, it's not just that, but Jesus points to, all the Passover points to Jesus and what he's done for us. Listen to some of these parallels here from the story. The Jews would pick out a lamb on the 10th of the month. Jesus entered Jerusalem on the 10th of that month. The lamb would live for them for 4 days. It would be taken into their home and cared for and become a part of the family. They would build relationship with it. Jesus spent 4 days in the temple teaching and connecting with the people, building relationships. When they came to arrest him, he said, I've been with you in the temple. I've been with you in your place of worship, in your homes. And why are you arresting me? He was innocent, but he spent 4 days teaching them in the temple. The Passover lamb was to be slaughtered at 3 p.m. Jesus died on the cross at 3 p.m. as our Passover lamb. And there it goes on and on and on, church, of how this moment of Passover that was 3,300 years ago points to Jesus. And then Jesus changes everything. He becomes our sacrifice. And then today our life must be marked by Jesus. Our homes must be set apart by Jesus. Today I want to talk about the door to your home. What is the door to your home marked by? Now, this doesn't mean it's just for families with kids or people that are married. If you live in a house, this applies to you. And not just the door to your physical home, but the door to your spiritual home, to your heart. What is your life marked by? Does it look different than the world around you? That's the question we're going to try to ask today. What is it that's supposed to be included in our home? What is it that's supposed to be excluded from our home? I want you to listen to this different perspective of an author that kind of wrote this story. This might help it come alive for you a little bit. Listen to this. The freshly plucked hyssop branch became heavy as it soaked up the thick blood from the clay basin. Smelling the pungent copper-like stench of so much blood was difficult to avoid. The air was filled with the cries of children who had just lost their newest friend, the lamb. He was spotless, young, from the flock, kept for a short time before his death. His blood, still warm, was dripping down the front of their homes. The children of Israel had been under Egyptian slavery for over 4 centuries. The God of their fathers was bringing them out of Egypt with a mighty hand. If they hadn't seen such amazing miracles with their own eyes, it would have been hard to believe what was going to happen that night. They had seen the Nile River turned into blood. They'd smelled the piles of rotting frogs in the fields. They heard the swarms of flies and locusts flying overhead. They witnessed the thick darkness that enveloped the entire land of Egypt for 3 days while all the Hebrews had light. The I Am hadn't failed them yet. They would trust him tonight with their lives. It was going to take something much more terrible for Pharaoh to let them go. Little did they realize that all that they were going through was going to vividly picture a much greater deliverance in the future. Doesn't that just open your eyes? Doesn't that connect you to what they were going through in that moment, that night, as they're sitting in their homes, their homes marked by the blood, and they're realizing that the only thing keeping them from that destroyer was the blood. The only thing that set them apart was that they were marked by the blood. Church, today you are marked by the blood of Jesus. It says in John 1:29 John declared Jesus was the Lamb of God who would take away the sin of the world. Your sins no longer rule over you. You are not controlled by your sins. You are not going to be affected by the destroyer. Hear me, church. Where the blood of Jesus is, the destroyer has no power. Do you believe that for your life? Or are you allowing him to have power? Do you understand where the blood of Jesus is? Where you're marked by the blood of Jesus, sin has no power. Where the blood of Jesus is, failure does not define you. Where the blood of Jesus is, your shame and your guilt does not control you. You have victory. You have victory. You will not be taken out. You need to have hope today. You need to trust that you are marked by the blood of Jesus, and that changes everything. It changed from this moment forward. Their lives changed. They were no longer slaves. They were free. You are no longer slaves to sin, church, but you are free. Can I get an amen? Let's give the Lord praise for that. Lord, we are thankful, God, that we are free by your blood, by what you've done for us, Father. Where the blood of Jesus is, the destroyer has no power. Now, I don't know about you, but I want to know what my home, what my life should look like if it's marked by the blood of Jesus. So I want to talk about three things today that should define your life, that are significant markers of a home that's set apart for Jesus. And these are things that I believe will people notice when your life is focused on Jesus. The first one is protection. Protection. A home that's marked by the blood of Jesus is protected. Psalm 127:1 says this: unless the Lord builds the house, the work of the builders is wasted. Unless the Lord protects the city, the guarding it with sentries will do no good. I have a question for you. When trouble comes, when you face trials, when you face things that come against you in life, what is your default to trust in? Because what you default to is what you depend on. I don't know about you, but you know, if you hit a financial crisis, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Is it to pray? Is it to seek the Lord? Or is it to say, man, I need to work some more shifts at work. Maybe I need to pick up a second job. Maybe we need to put a little bit more money away for an emergency. You know, those aren't bad things, but what's your default? Who's your protector? See, the Israelites came to the place where they finally realized the only person, the only thing that they could rely on was God. They put all of their life into God's hands and under his authority. They had no power to protect themselves, did they? Were they any match for the destroying angel? No. Sometimes we think we're a match for our own problems in life, and we try to handle them on our own. God, I got this problem. I'll get back with you when I get a big one that I can't handle. But that's such a lie. Our homes, our house, our life must be marked by God and his protection. And when you submit to that and say, God, not my will, but yours be done. When you say, God, I'm gonna be my first response, may it be to pray. May it be to seek your will. God, what is your will? Should I buy this house? Should I buy this car? Should I do this? Should I do that? But I'm not gonna trust in myself. I'm gonna lean on you. And when you come under God's protection, under God's lordship like that, you're safe. You're under the umbrella of his lordship. That's where we're called to be. See, this world is defined by fear. Fear sells in the media, doesn't it? It sells on the news. They try to get you to respond. Man, this thing's happened. This evil's in the world. You need more security cameras. You need more of this in your house. You need to protect yourself here. You need to get more insurance. You need to do all that. The government needs more programs to take care of you. They're trying. It's all fear-based. None of that's bad. But where is your default? Who do you trust in for your life? The second one is purity. A home marked by Jesus is marked by purity. Now, when we hear the word purity, most of the time we think about things like this, you know, we're in Valentine's Day and pure dating relationships or things like that. I kiss dating goodbye. Maybe that's a little dated. That's a little old, but we think about that as kind of our default. But purity must mark the life of a disciple of Jesus. Purity must mark our life. How different does our life look than the world around us? See, the Israelites had to purify themselves. They had to consecrate themselves. They had to remove the yeast from their homes. And in the Bible, throughout the Bible, almost every single time that yeast is mentioned, it's a symbol of sin. Now, why is yeast a symbol of sin? Because it's unseen and it affects everything. Oftentimes the sins that affect us the most are the hidden ones. And they have a way of affecting our entire life, whether we know it or not. When we have a hidden sin, it affects the whole batch. It affects your whole life. Really, there's no such thing as a hidden sin because it's gonna come out and it's gonna affect everything. So the Israelites had to remove this yeast, and they made a strong demand or command that if they did not do that, they were cut off from the community. Listen to this New Testament correlation. We read part of this verse earlier. 1 Corinthians 5, verses 6 through 8. Your boasting about this is terrible. Don't you realize that sin is like a little yeast? It spreads through the whole batch of dough. Get rid of the old yeast by removing the wicked person from among you. Then you will be like a fresh batch of dough made without yeast, which is what you really are. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. So celebrate this festival, not in wickedness and evil, but in the new bread of sincerity and truth. So it says, you are already a pure vessel. God's blood has marked you. He says, you are already yeast-free or sin-free by the blood of Jesus. Now get rid of anything else that's gonna affect that. that's gonna dampen you, that's gonna affect you in any way. What does scripture call out as these kind of things? It could be a lot of things. You can read the scripture. The word of God is living and active. And if there's things in your life that the Lord wants to remove, he's gonna show them to you. Not to condemn you, not to make you feel bad, but to cut that thing out like cancer. So it needs to be removed from your life so that you can live full of the presence of God and full of his power and his freedom and his love. So Ephesians 4:29-32 calls out some of the things that we need to remove from our life. It says, remove unwholesome talk, remove bitterness, remove rage, anger, slander, and anything, hear this church, anything that grieves the Holy Spirit. Now, God's not telling us to remove those things because he doesn't want us to have fun. When's the last time that bitterness, rage, anger, and slander were fun? God's not trying to steal your fun. And things that grieve the Holy Spirit, he's not trying to steal your fun. He's trying to get you into a place where you can enjoy the fullness of life, the fullness of his blessing, the fullness of his presence and his love inside of you and inside your home. So what does your home look like? I feel like back in the day, and this is gonna make me feel a little old, but all the things that we were kind of the vices of our life were more visible. When you walked into someone's home, you knew a little bit about the family by looking at the movies on their DVDs, right? Or their VHS tapes. Or you knew by looking at their CD rack or their stack of magazines or their books. You could see what they were consuming. Does that make sense? You following me? Nowadays, you don't see those things. They're all digital, aren't they? So the question you have to ask yourself is, where do I start with purifying my heart? Start with looking at your Netflix history. Look at your YouTube feed. Look at who you follow on Instagram. See, it got really quiet in here. Whew. Like, if we're getting real, preacher, don't do this. But think about this. I'm not trying to condemn you, but I'm trying to challenge you to look at those things. Be intentional with what you allow in to your life. We do this really good for our kids. We have four boys, my wife and I do, and we work really hard to protect them because we know that a kid's innocence and their purity is affected by what they see, hear, and do. Is that true? You know that's the same for you? We're doing really good at this for our kids, but I don't think we're that good at it for ourselves. I mean, I'm just being real with you. I feel like sometimes we filter our kids' lives really well, but then we're like, you know what? It's so easy. It's so much easier to watch a movie you shouldn't watch than it used to be. You just scroll through Netflix and you click on the movie. It's all there. Everything you could ever want to watch, good, bad, ugly. Before, you had to go to the Blockbuster and you had to go and you had to walk down the aisle and you had to rent it and you had to walk up to a human being who had to look at the movie that you were about to watch and give it back to you, you know? Like, there was a lot of steps to get to that point. It's not so hard anymore, is it? So we have to be more vigilant, church. We have to be more intentional, not legalistically, but because God's presence dwells inside of you. God's presence dwells in your home, and he wants the fullness of his love and his presence and his power and his peace to dwell in you. Amen. Man, it gets a little quiet in here. But I you understand what I'm saying. God wants you to be intentional, to guard your home, to remove the things that are not honoring him, that are gonna grieve the Holy Spirit, not because he doesn't love you, but because he does. He does. The third thing that our homes are marked by is peace. Peace. John 14:27 says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled, and do not let it be afraid. Isaiah 26:3, this one's not in your notes, you can write it to the side, says, you will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed on you. Isn't it true that our culture, people are grasping for peace? They're grasping for peace. You look at the front of a magazine and it's like 10 steps to meditation to calm yourself. We have all these drugs that are supposed to help us out and help us feel better. We have all this stuff that's around us and they're grasping for peace everywhere but the source of peace. He says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you as a gift. I don't give as the world gives. Means the world doesn't have this gift to give you. You can't find it apart from me. But I want to give it to you. I want your home, I want your life to be marked by my peace. I know when God's presence is with me because I feel this anchor of peace. It's not just warm fuzzies. It's a true peace. I know if I'm in the place I'm supposed to be because of peace. I know I'm in the place I'm not supposed to be because I don't have peace. I know I'm watching something I shouldn't watch because I don't have peace. And I want to guard that. I want to guard that presence in my home and in my life. I think one of the most powerful testimonies I've had in my life is just having people over to our home and them commenting on how it feels because God's presence dwells there. And even inviting in some young people that needed a place to stay and letting them stay with us for a while. And they literally, we had a guy come in that he stayed with us and he was on 5 different medications with all these different things going wrong. Within a couple months, we didn't do anything. He just quit his medications and he was fine. He was on all these ADHD and all this stuff, and in the presence of God in our home, God began to set him free. And he was set free because of the presence of God, not because of us. But there's power in allowing your home to be an atmosphere of the Holy Spirit. And God's calling us out to be set apart from the culture. You know, the enemy knows this. He knows that the most powerful force on the planet is a family fully devoted to Jesus. The most powerful force on the planet, hear me church, is a family fully devoted to Jesus. Because a family is where discipleship happens. It's where growth happens. I want to share, listen to this. This is shocking. There was a study done of 2 families in the 18th century. And the difference of their life, one family is a family that followed the Lord, that raised their kids and to know the Lord, and one was a family that was marked by sin and destruction. Listen to this. Jonathan and Sarah Edwards had 11 children. I'm not saying this was all Jonathan. Sarah was the great discipler here, all right? Can I get an amen for stay-at-home moms? Come on. They have the one of the hardest jobs in the world. When I stay home, I am far more exhausted than when I go to work all day long. So if you're a stay-at-home parent or a single parent, hear me. God's given you the grace, and I'm thankful for what you do because you disciple the next generation. But listen to what they did. 11 kids that they nurtured and they taught in the ways of the Lord. Listen to what followed in their legacy. These are people that came out of this family line directly from these 2 parents and their kids. There was 1 U.S. vice president, 1 dean of law school, 1 dean of medical school, 3 U.S. senators, 3 governors, 3 mayors, 13 college presidents, 30 judges, 60 doctors, 65 professors, 75 military officers, 80 public office holders, 100 lawyers, 100 clergymen, and 285 college graduates. Look at the ripple effect of a family that followed the Lord. The other family that was studied was a man named Max Jukes, which we wouldn't have known about him except for his legacy came to people's attention when his family trees, listen to this, family trees of 42 men in the New York prison were traced back to him. 42 men in the New York prison were traced back to him. And listen, as they started to study his descendants, they included 7 murderers, 60 thieves, 190 prostitutes, 150 convicts, 310 paupers, 440 who were wrecked by alcohol addiction. And of the 1,200 descendants that were studied, 300 died prematurely. You see what the enemy's goal is? You see why he's attacking families so much? Because he knows a family that's set apart to follow the Lord is the most powerful force for the kingdom of God. Because those families have a ripple effect for generations. Blessing continues from generation to generation to generation. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes I look at this and maybe you feel like your family looks a lot more like the Jukes family than the Edwards family. Maybe you see where the enemy has succeeded in causing some destruction in your family. I want you to know today that today that can end. Today is an opportunity for you to stand up and to stand in the gap for your family and to say, today I stand. And I say, we will be a family that follows the Lord. Joshua 24 says, I don't know what you're gonna do, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And you can stand today. You can mark your family today. You can mark your home. And you can say, we're not gonna stand for this, for the sins that have tried to take us out, for the addiction that's tried to take us out. We're gonna break that in Jesus' name, by the blood of Jesus. Yes, and we're gonna move forward into the blessing and the power and the presence of God, because he is for you and he is with you in this moment. Today is a day of liberation. Today is a day of freedom. And if it's not for you, you will stand today in a moment in the gap for someone else in your family. You can stand up and say, I'm gonna declare blessing. I'm gonna declare breakthrough. I'm gonna declare healing over them in Jesus' name. See, that's the cool thing about this story. The blood didn't have to be on each individual person. They marked the home, and everyone that came into that home got to experience the sanctification and the blessing. I'm not saying salvation is individual. Hear me, church. But you can stand up and you can declare blessing over your family. You can stand up and you can bring them under the protection of your family. Just like Job prayed for his kids that they wouldn't sin, he was covering them. He was covering them with prayer. And it was powerful. Until the day that they knew better, until the day that they sought the Lord themselves, you can stand. You can draw people in. I wrote some lines in your notes of three things that you might need to take out to purify your home. You can write more than that, whatever you want. And maybe that's some, there's some resources at the end of your notes. You'll see some websites there of ways you can start to monitor this. Before I go see a movie with my kids, I read that review on pluggedin.com as a Christian worldview review site. So I'll read reviews. I don't just assume every cartoon's gonna be okay because it's a cartoon. You go find out what's actually in there. What's the worldview that it's preaching? And you make sure that you're diligent and intentional in your home. And then I wrote three things to allow into your home. Maybe you've been set apart from the Lord, but you've been hiding from the world a little bit. And God said, I want you to bring your neighbors in. I want you to go knock on their doors and show them my love. I want you to have a small group in your home. I want you to let worship reign in your home and not have secular music there. I don't know. I want you to mark the word of God all over the walls of your home. You can allow those things in to set your home apart for the Lord. It's more than just a sign on the door that says, bless this house. It is just like we prayed during 21 days of prayer that God would anoint our homes. He would set us apart as a testimony, as a powerful place where people can be brought into the presence of God. I believe God wants to set some people free today. I believe he wants to purify us a little bit. And if he's showing you specific things, I would challenge you, if there's something specific you need to remove from your home, from your life, write it down. Because when you write it down, you're holding yourself accountable. And if there's things that you want to open your heart to allow God to use you, you realize, man, we have a good family. Maybe we're called to be foster parents. To minister to kids that don't have this kind of home. I don't know what it is, but you can write those things down. And I believe God wants to do some work today to begin to set us apart, but also to set us free and to launch us into the future as people that are set apart, liberated by God, and ready to walk in the power of the blood of Jesus. If you're here maybe today and you realize this is not my life. I don't understand. I don't know Jesus. I've really not let my life be marked by the blood of Jesus today. 2 Corinthians 6:2 says this, for God says, at just the right time, I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation. And I just want to encourage you today, if you've been marked by destruction, if you've been marked by hopelessness or addiction, today is the day to allow God to set you free.